Wow. Yep, that's about the size we're used to seeing in Costa Rica. Look at that.
Perfect, good, don't change anything.
Ooh, this is gonna be wicked. Oh, wowzers.
Nature is riddled with dangers, and to the untrained eye, if you don't recognize one of its many biological landmines, it's possible that your next step could be your last. Spiders, scorpions, centipedes, and even spiky plants can be considered explosively perilous if they catch you off guard. But nothing is more serious than stepping on a venomous snake. On this adventure, we're going to take a look at Central and South America's most notorious pit viper, a snake that I am all too familiar with, and a reptile you should definitely be aware of, lest you accidentally encounter it while hiking in the rainforest.
Whoa, 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 whoa.
What do you got?
We got a Fer-de-Lance right in front of us, right under this leaf. Wait, look at this. Right in front of me, right in front of me. Look at that camouflage. Holy cow, his head's coming right up past that leaf. Oh my gosh. That is the camouflage that you hope you recognize before you step too close. The snake literally just curled up underneath the leaf. Its nose is just poking up right in the middle of the path that we are walking down.
I don't see it.
Right, look at this bright leaf in front of me. You see this? Its nose is just sticking up on the top of it. You see that?
Got it. Keep your light there.
Completely hidden, the Fer-de-Lance, arguably the most dangerous snake in Central and South America. Yes, I was hoping we'd see one of these tonight. One thing we've never done before is tube one of these vipers and take a closer look from that position. So I'm gonna slowly lift back this leaf. I have no idea how big the snake is. This is sometimes the funnest part. What's the leaf going to reveal? How big is this snake? It looks sizable.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah, that's a good size snake. Oh, buddy, look at you. Okay. Right now, it is still saying to itself, I'm hidden. Nobody sees me. If I don't move, maybe you guys will just pass right by, and I'll continue about my night hunting for prey items. But we definitely want to get a better look. All right, Mario, the snake is actually in an absolutely perfect position for us to try to get it safely inside of a snake tube. It's the safest situation for the snake, and it will put the least amount of stress on it as possible. Get your camera too much closer than that. What's amazing about these snakes is that they can go from completely gargoyle statue still into explosive action. And these snakes can launch themselves 2/3 the length of their body forward, which is why they are incredibly dangerous to work with. And just like that, I drop my snake tongs and the snake is on the move. Okay.
Okay, we need light.
It's just kind of slithering slowly, which is good. It's not being too explosive. Like I said, they can move incredibly quick when they need to. Whoa, 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 careful.
All right, Coyote, you gonna step in?
Yeah. Here, I'll tell you what, why don't you take the snake hook? I'll take the tube. You got the right gauge.
You're gonna have to pick it out.
Okay, go ahead, switch. This never gets any easier. This is definitely the most dangerous part. Angled down.
Angled. Not yet. Now.
Okay. Got it. There we go. Ooh, look at the fangs inside there. Very, very gentle now. Okay. You just have to take a deep breath after successfully getting control of a snake like that because the bite from this species is extremely toxic. Hemotoxic and mitotoxic, it will break down red blood cells. This is one of the most potent bites of any venomous snake on the western half of the world. And if you're bitten by a snake like this and you do not get the proper care, it could take your life. Now, when I turn the snake like this, you can see the scalation is very, very defined. It's very rigid, very bumpy. It's got incredible texture to it. And that texture also helps to keep these snakes camouflaged. one of the names that this snake is commonly known by is the lance head, and that's because of the triangular nature of the head. Almost looks like the tip of a lance or a spear. And like all pit vipers, they have a heat sensing pit, which of course helps them to detect their prey. And while they will take advantage of mammals, certain times of year these snakes primarily feast on amphibians. And with all the rain that just recently moved through earlier, I'm guessing this snake is on the hunt for any sort of creature that can possibly come across. Whether it's a mammal or an amphibian, it is fair game if you are a snake like this out and on the hunt. Now, one of the reasons I was so excited to have come across a Fer-de-Lance tonight is that I've always wanted to show you guys what happens when you mix this pit viper's venom with blood, human blood. But to safely do that, we're gonna need to head back to DeLand, Florida and connect with our friends at the Reptile Discovery Center. We can actually get hands-on with one of these snakes in captivity and safely show you guys what it takes to not only milk this species, but also to mix its venom with human blood. Stay tuned, guys. I promise the second part of this episode is going to be wildly entertaining.
Interacting with a Fer-de-Lance is like handling a loaded gun, and just a single mistake could quickly turn into a medical emergency or worse. This species is responsible for 90% of the snake bites in Central America, making them the most dangerous snake in their range. Sounds horrific, but here's the good news. If a bite victim is taken to the hospital in a timely manner and anti-venom is administered, the survival rate is extremely high. We have returned to the Reptile Discovery Center in DeLand, Florida. Millions of you enjoyed the previous episodes we filmed here, so it's an absolute honor for us to return and once again work alongside Carl and Mara. This serpentarium is not only home to dozens of the world's most dangerous snakes, it is also the first step in the production of life-saving antivenoms. Yet in order for antivenom to be created, first you need the snake's venom. And to get the venom, you need to milk the snakes.
Behind us is a room filled with snakes, and in one of those boxes is the Fer-de-Lance, Central and South America's most notorious snake, and today we're going to milk it. Are you guys ready for this?
We're ready.
I think so.
Are you nervous?
Never.
Let's bring out the snake.
Beautiful. Okay, Coyote, she's coming up.
All right. Now remember, Carl and Mara are professionals. They do this on a weekly basis working with these snakes, but it's gonna be really interesting to see the Fer-de-Lance not in its natural environment. I don't know what the snake's gonna look like, how big it's going to be, so I'm ready to be surprised. This is gonna get intense. Oh boy, here we go, okay. Wow, yep, that's about the size we're used to seeing in Costa Rica. Look at that.
They are big, well-adapted pit vipers. They have highly developed venoms. Toxic venoms tend to be tremendously hemolytic, and in other words, do lots of destruction to blood cells. And so they account for a lot of bites in South America, as you know, or Central and South America. And so it's a formidable pit viper.
So a bite from this snake without anti-venom is almost guaranteed to kill you.
I'm not gonna say always lethal, because again, sometimes a bite from that snake will result in a minor envenomation. He won't give you anything. Mm-hmm. But a severe or a significant envenomation by that snake without treatment would probably result in fatality.
Okay.
Or perhaps the loss of a limb.
Okay, so Carl, at this point, the snake is looking right at us. I feel like it's probably a good point to milk this snake. What's this process gonna look like?
So the catch here is gonna be a little bit different. If you start to really look at that snake's body language, Coyote, he's starting to kind of get act up a little bit. He's starting to get nervous, and Fer-de-Lance can be really flighty snakes.
Now, have you ever had one jump off of the table?
We have.
Yeah,
just not quite as far as you.
I keep wanting to look off at the camera, but then I'm keeping my eye on the snake.
Very
it looks
much.
Like it's in launch mode. Okay.
Absolutely.
I think this is probably the moment. What do you guys need me to do?
Just step off to the right a little bit. We're going to give Mara a little room to kind of work our magic.
Get him secured, and then I'll hand him over to you.
Nice.
Okay,
right,
the pressure's coming down.
Oh, wound up.
Ooh,
nice
strike.
And there's full pressure on
the neck. Perfect, good, don't change anything. Perfect.
Ah, it's a strong snake.
Good.
So Carl, this is the most important part right here, right?
Yep, and you'll see, normally Fer-de-Lance are good, solid venom producers. It went light today. Okay, sometimes the snake's gonna give us only a small amount of her venom, or his venom. the big difference here is you've heard the term milking snakes.
And yes.
In the old days, they used to press on those venom glands. They'd squeeze that snake's head. We don't do that. We just allow the snake to bite and give us what he's going to give us voluntarily. And sometimes they don't give us a lot of venom. Remember, venom to the snake is precious. These are defensive bites, and he really has venom to obtain his food.
Mm-hmm.
Great job on the body.
Okay.
So I'm going to go back into the cage now. But even that little bit, you're looking at about 100 milligrams of dry weight there. That's absolutely probably multiple lethal doses of venom.
Wow.
Good.
Okay.
Beautiful job, Coyote.
Good,
I got him. Yep.
Okay.
Perfect job. Thank you.
Did you hear that? So just that amount of venom, not even a full venom yield, capable of killing multiple people when it's at dry weight. Now, Carl, question for you.
Yes.
What is this venom going to do to your body?
So the little thing in your bloodstream that allows platelets to stick to it and clot is actually being broken apart by some of these venoms. It's being lysed into pieces. And so that net there, that clotting net that's going to allow the platelets to stick to it, is being destroyed. And so all of a sudden you're beginning to hemorrhage, you're beginning to bleed, you go into shock, you've got all kinds of fluid problems, your kidneys are beginning to fail because you've got all these things floating around in your bloodstream that shouldn't be there. And of course, like all pit viper bites, lance heads swell and they destroy tissue, something they call metalloproteinases. So it's a messy snake bite, it's a painful snake bite. They often result in amputations because of a delay in treatment or no treatment. So you'll see people missing fingers or even bigger parts of their body with these guys. So it's a dangerous snake.
It is serious business if you're bitten, so you have to admire the snake from a safe distance. Now the next thing that we want to do is take this venom and mix it together with blood. Of course, my blood, and this time in less of a rudimentary situation, and we're going to put it underneath the microscope and see if we can see some of those blood cells breaking down.
That sounds excellent. You're stepping up your experiment a little bit. We really applaud that. And as you said, maybe we'll get lucky and we'll be able to see some of these toxins at work under a microscope.
Okay, stay tuned, guys. The next part of this episode is going to get extremely scientific.